5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
In 1959, the U.S. Central Intelligence Agency, the CIA, planned the invasion of Cuba. Eventually, the Bay of Pigs, or Bahia de Cochinos, on the island's southern coast was chosen because the nearby town of Giron had an airfield that could be used by rebel Cuban aircraft. In 1960, Alabama Governor John Patterson approved a plan to recruit Air National Guard personnel to assist the CIA. Their mission was to train and advise Cuban exiles to fly, arm, and maintain 16 Douglas B-26C invaders painted to resemble those used in the Cuban Air Force, but not to fly combat missions themselves. The Alabama Air National Guard had been chosen to train the exiles because they were the last American military flying unit to fly and maintain the obsolete B-26 bomber. Invasion planners had all 16 of the B-26s converted to house 850 caliber machine guns in the nose with 5-inch rocket launchers and 250-gallon drop tanks under the wings. They were painted in the colors and insignia and even the actual numbers of real Cuban Air Force B-26s, hoping that the Cuban population would believe that Castro's own pilots were in revolt against him and inspiring the people to join the invasion force in a mass uprising. The Cuban pilots were trained in the weeks prior to the invasion at a secret airfield at Retoluleo in the Sierra Madre Mountains in Guatemala. Prior to the invasion, the group moved to a secret CIA staging base in Puerto Cabezas, Nicaragua, called Happy Valley. Shortly before the invasion, President Kennedy ordered the aerial attack mission to be reduced from 16 aircraft to only 8 to reduce American exposure. As a result, less than half of Castro's 16 operational aircraft were disabled, leaving the rest to lay in wait for the invasion. Here is how the air battle unfolded. April 15, 1961. The first two air operations were unrelated but occurred at about the same time. A Cuban Air Force reconnaissance sortie over the Baracoa area was launched from the airfield at Santiago de Cuba using a Cuban T-33, but it crashed into the sea, killing the pilot, Lieutenant Orestes Acostas. The reason for the loss is unknown. To the south, 8 B-26 bombers of the CIA's Cuba Expeditionary Force approached the island to carry out airstrikes at 3 sites in an attempt to destroy Castro's air capability on the ground. 3 of the B-26s attacked targets at the airfield at Campo Libertad, and 3 other B-26s attacked parked aircraft at the airfield at San Antonio de los Baños. Both airfields are near Havana. 2 B-26s attacked the airfield at Santiago de Cuba near Guantanamo Bay. The planes were to jettison their drop tanks over the water and then make 3 passes each to destroy all combat aircraft parked on the airfields. One of the B-26s attacking San Antonio de los Baños, call sign Linda 3, ran into trouble early when one of its wing-mounted drop tanks refused to feed its fuel into the main tank. The pilot, Alfredo Maza, was also unable to get his guns to fire. He was the third ship in the flight, and he made his attack using the 5-inch rockets mounted under the wings, but due to the smoke from the previous attacking aircraft, he had trouble seeing the targets. Since he had been unable to use the fuel from the one drop tank, he could not return to Happy Valley in Puerto Cabezas. He diverted to Grand Cayman, where his aircraft was immediately interned. It still had a 5-inch rocket hanging partly off the launch rail. He was allowed to take a commercial British flight to Miami the next day, but his aircraft was seized by the Cayman authorities. The initial pilot reports were exaggerated and indicated that 75 to 80% of Castro's planes were destroyed, but in fact it was only 10 aircraft, of which only 7 were combat aircraft. At Santiago, the two attackers destroyed a PBY Catalina flying boat, 2 B-26 bombers, and a civilian DC-3 airliner, plus various other civilian aircraft. At San Antonio, the attackers destroyed 3 B-26s, 1 Sea Fury, and 1 T-33. At Ciudad Libertad, the attackers destroyed only non-operational aircraft, such as 2 derelict P-47 Thunderbolts. One of those attackers was shot down by anti-aircraft fire with the loss of the crew, Daniel Fernandez Mon and Gaston Perez. It crashed at sea about 24 miles north of Cuba. Its companion B-26 was also damaged but managed to limp to the American Naval Air Station at Key West, Florida, Boca Chica. The crew, Jose Crespo and Lorenzo Perez Lorenzo were granted political asylum. At 7 a.m., a 9th B-26 arrived at Miami, complete with staged bullet holes. The Cuban pilot claimed that he and three of his comrades had defected from Castro's Air Force in stolen planes. They claimed to have carried out the attacks against Castro's airfields, and after being hit by anti-aircraft fire and low on fuel, flew to the United States. But aviation-savvy reporters noted the plane's machine guns had evidently not been fired, and its nose was a metal gun nose C model, while Castro's B-26s had plexiglass bombardier noses. It must be noted that many civilians were also killed in these attacks, yet Castro still had half of his combat air force, and the CIA had effectively lost three planes. After the attacks, and expecting further attempts to destroy his small air force, Castro ordered his pilots to sleep under the wings of the planes and to be ready for takeoff immediately. April 16, 1961. No combat air operations flew on the 16th, but the CIA's airborne battalion was flown from their base at Guatemala to Puerto Cabezas. Also, pilots Crespo and Lorenzo made their way from Boca Chica back to Happy Valley on the CIA's daily C-54 flight from Opa-locka Airport to Happy Valley. Their B-26, purposely numbered 933 as part of a disinformation campaign, was left behind. Following the airstrikes on 15 April 1961, the Cubans managed to prepare at least four T-33s, four Hawker Sea Furies, and five B-26s for combat. All three types were armed with machine guns except the Sea Furies, which carried 20mm cannons. This was for air-to-air combat and strafing of ground targets. CIA planners had also failed to discover that the T-33 jets were armed with 50 caliber machine guns. No additional strikes against Cuban airfields and aircraft were specifically planned before the 17th of April because of the exaggerated claims of the B-26 pilots on their initial attacks. However, once Air Force U-2 reconnaissance photos showed the truth, the CIA hastily planned more attacks on Castro's airfields. But late on the 16th, President Kennedy ordered a cancellation of the airfield strikes. At about 9:30 p.m., the CIA was told that the Dawn airstrikes were canceled. The order canceling the strikes was dispatched to Happy Valley, but it did not arrive until early the next morning. April 17th, 0400 hours. Castro calls Captain Enrique Carreras at San Antonio Air Base, 20 miles west of Havana, to emphasize that their first objective is any CIA aircraft parked on the airstrip at Giron. Secondary targets are the boats and ships, and his third mission is to observe if there is any movement of trucks near Giron. At Happy Valley, the pilots are in their dark pre-dawn cockpits ready for takeoff when the word canceling the airstrike reaches them. CIA officials try to mitigate the damage by warning the invasion force of likely air attacks and to expedite unloading. A continuous cover of two B-26s over the beach will be provided in lieu of the strikes. At 0600 hours, the Cuban pilots take off, about 20 minutes before daylight. At 0620, the Cuban Air Force makes its attacks on shipping at Blue Beach. This happens before the CIA planes can arrive. Three Hawker Sea Furies, one B-26, and two Lockheed T-33 fighter jets start attacking the CIA ships, which are still unloading troops. The supply ship Houston comes under attack and is hit and goes down about 5 miles from the landing beach. During this air attack, strafing and machine gun fire also damage a landing craft. Just 10 minutes later, friendly air support arrives in the form of two CIA B-26s, but by this time, the Cuban Air Force has left the scene. At 0700, two CIA bombers attack and sink a Cuban Navy patrol escort ship at Nueva Gorona off the Isle of Pines. They then proceed to Giron to join two other B-26s to attack Cuban ground troops and provide distraction for the paratroop operations that are about to take place. At 0730, five C-46 Curtis Commandos and one C-54 transport drop 177 paratroopers from the Parachute Battalion of Brigade 2506 in an action codenamed Operation Falcon. About 30 men plus heavy equipment were dropped south of the Central Australia Sugar Mill on the road to Palpite and Playa Larga. But the equipment was lost in the swamps and the troops failed to block the road. Other troops were dropped at San Blas, at Yacuma between Covadonga and San Blas, and Orquitas between Yaguaramas and San Blas. At 0825, the ship Blagar shoots down a Cuban T-33. All troops are now ashore at Blue Beach. At about 0830, a Cuban Sea Fury, piloted by pilot Carlos Arauz, sees a CIA C-46 returning after dropping the paratroopers. Exactly what happened is unclear, but he crashed into the bay, possibly either due to stalling or anti-aircraft fire. 0930, the freighter Rio Escondido, attacked by a Sea Fury and T-33s, sinks due to a direct rocket hit. It had 10 days' reserves of ammunition on board, as well as food, hospital equipment, and gasoline. 10 a.m. In face of continuous air attacks, the contract skipper in charge of the shipping radios the CIA headquarters that if jet air coverage is not available immediately, the ships will put to sea. 10:30, following the air attack which sank the freighters, all others in the landing area put to sea with the orders to rendezvous 50 miles south of the coast. They are under constant air attack as they withdraw. 11 a.m., a Cuban T-33 attacks a CIA B-26, number 935, piloted by Matias Farias and Eduardo Gonzalez. Gonzalez is killed by gunfire, but Farias is able to crash land on the airstrip at Giron. His companion B-26, flown by Mario Zuniga and navigator Oscar Vega, suffer damage and divert to Grand Cayman. The airplane is interned alongside of Alfredo Maza's B-26. The British keep both planes firmly grounded to prevent anyone from thinking that the operation is being conducted out of the Caymans. About noontime, a Cuban B-26 attacks the ship Blagar, which is now in international waters. The B-26 explodes when it is hit by heavy anti-aircraft fire from Blagar. Its pilot, Luis Silva Tablada, on his second sortie, and his crew of three are lost. During the day, three CIA B-26s were shot down by Cuban T-33s, with the loss of pilots Raul Vianello, Jose Crespo, Osvaldo Piedra, and navigators Lorenzo Pierre Lorenzo and Jose Fernandez. Vianello's navigator, Demetrio Perez, bailed out and was picked up by the destroyer USS Murray. Pilot Grispin Garcia Fernandez and navigator Juan Gonzalez Romero in B-26 number 940 diverted to Boca Chica. By 4 p.m., B-26 aircraft are being rotated over the beachhead throughout the day. They have sunk one gunboat, made strikes against Cuban ground troops at Red Beach, and inflicted several hundred casualties. But four B-26s are lost to T-33 action, three shot down with one crash landing at Giron, and another diverted to Grand Cayman. Add to this the one shot down and the one diverted to Grand Cayman on the first day, plus the CIA's deception aircraft, and the CIA only has 8 of 16 aircraft left in service. By comparison, Castro's Air Force losses of one T-33, two Sea Furies, and two B-26s leaves the Cuban Air Force with a slight advantage. Late in the evening at Boca Chica, the Cuban CIA crew, Fernandez and Romero, who had just arrived earlier in the day in the crippled B-26 number 940, wanted to return to Happy Valley. The deception aircraft, B-26 number 933, that had arrived at Boca Chica 2 days earlier, was still there and was still operational. They took 933 and tried to ferry it back to Happy Valley. They never made it. April 18, 1961. Responding to the ease with which the T-33s destroyed the obsolete B-26s, CIA leaders issued orders to bomb as many airfields as possible on the ground on the night of April 17th to 18th with fragmentation bombs. Three B-26s are launched for San Antonio de los Baños but fail to find the target. At noon, Blue Beach is reported under attack by T-33s. National Security Advisor George McBundy reports to the President that the Cuban armed forces are stronger, the popular response is weaker, and the tactical position is feebler than anyone had hoped. Bundy tells Kennedy the CIA will press hard for further air help, and he recommends that they eliminate Castro's Air Force by using neutrally painted U.S. aircraft if necessary, and then let the battle go its own way. 2 p.m., with only about a third of the exhausted Cuban pilots at Puerto Cabezas able and willing to continue flying, Bissell, for the first time, authorizes American pilots to fly combat missions. Two CIA contract men, Peters and Sieg, joined by Cuban pilots, head for Cuba. Castro's troops mistake them for friendly aircraft, and instead of dispersing, they begin to cheer. The 6th Brigade planes swoop down, dropping napalm and regular bombs, firing rockets, inflicting what is claimed as many as 1,800 casualties and 7 tanks destroyed. 3 p.m., the Joint Chiefs of Staff direct the Commander-in-Chief Atlantic Forces to prepare unmarked naval aircraft for possible combat. The aircraft are ready, but permission is not given to use them. At the airbase in San Antonio, Captain Corbelos outlines the day's priorities to the Cuban pilots to bomb and fire on Playa Larga, destroy buildings in the hands of the enemy, and prevent the enemy receiving reinforcements of war materials. At 5 p.m., B-26 planes of the invading forces launch an attack on advancing troops and tanks of Battalion 123, firing rockets and dropping napalm and causing extensive casualties. The CIA base commander at Happy Valley, who called himself Gar, received a telegram from his boss in D.C. on April 18, 1961, authorizing the use of American pilots as long as they remained over the beachhead and sea approaches. They were not to fly inland, which would increase the chance of them being shot down or captured, thereby confirming America's involvement. Pilots Mario Zuniga and navigator Oscar Vega returned to Puerto Cabezas via the CIA C-54 from the Cayman Islands. April 19, 1961. At a meeting at the White House that begins just after midnight, the President, Vice President, and Admiral Arleigh Burke, along with other senior officers, hear a report on the decline of the invasion force. Burke asked the President to let him send 2 jets up to shoot down the enemy aircraft, but the President declines. He will not commit U.S. forces to combat. Around 1 a.m., the President authorizes 1 hour of air cover from 0630 to 0730 for the invading brigades, B-26s, by 6 unmarked jets from the carrier Essex. The jets are not to seek air combat nor attack ground targets. By the morning of April 19th, 9 of the invading forces' 16 aircraft have either been shot down, disabled, or diverted. Many of the remaining aircraft are in poor flying condition. The CIA finally authorized the Alabama Air National Guardsmen to fly on April 19th. The men were warned that should they be captured, the United States would declare them as mercenaries and disavow any knowledge of their activities. Despite this grim prospect, 8 men stepped forward, 4 pilots and 4 crewmen. The lead formation was commanded by Billy Dodo Goodwin, Alabama pilots Joe Shannon, Riley Schamberger, and Thomas Willard Pete Ray volunteered along with Alabama crew members Leo Baker, Wade Gray, Nick Sedano, and James Vaughn. All men were volunteers. A second exiled Cuban pilot, Mario Zuniga, and his crew member joined the strike force of B-26s. The records do not indicate whether Herrera had a crew member with him or not. He may have flown alone, as by this time volunteers were getting scarce. At 0550, a lone CIA Curtiss C-46 commando cargo plane landed at Giron carrying 850 pounds of munitions, maps, messages, and communications equipment. Landing on the Giron airstrip in the dark was an extremely hazardous affair. After dropping off equipment, picking up messages and maps, and the wounded pilot that had been shot down the day before, the C-46 took off in the dark, and none too soon. At 0600 hours, the Cuban Air Force began ground attack operations. According to Joe Shannon, there had been plans all along to use the American pilots if Cubans could not continue to fly. However, only 2 of the designated American pilots, Pete Ray and Billy Goodwin, were available at Happy Valley. Gar had asked Shannon and Schamberger if they would be willing to fly, even though they had been told previously by the agency that they would not be allowed to do so over security concerns. Shannon states that Gar had no authority to let us go, and that we weren't supposed to go, but we had become so attached to the Cubans down there that their fight was our fight. So we agreed to fly this last-minute desperation mission just to let those guys know they weren't forgotten. The 5 B-26s were part of what was called Mad Dog Flight. Shannon flew with Carl Nick Sedano, serving as his navigator. Schamberger flew with Wade Gray. Billy Goodwin flew with James Vaughn, and Pete Ray flew with Leo Baker. The 2 Cuban pilots, Herrera and Zuniga, refused to stand down from the mission despite their exhaustion. Early on the 19th, the six B-26 invaders, painted in Cuban Air Force colors, but managed by the eight Alabama and perhaps three or four Cuban exile pilots, took off from Happy Valley and headed towards Cuba. The guardsmen were promised air cover from the USS Essex, a U.S. aircraft carrier just off the coast of Cuba in international waters. But as the bombers arrived over the beachhead, the Navy jets were nowhere to be seen, but Castro's fighters lay in wait for them. Lieutenant Colonel Joe Shannon and Major Riley Schamberger made landfall about 20 miles east of the Bay of Pigs, then turned and followed the coastline. It was about 6 in the morning. As they approached the beachhead, they identified a column of military vehicles as their first target. Shannon had the napalm, so he went in first. Schamberger moved from Shannon's right wing to his left. This put Schamberger closest to an unseen Cuban T-33 jet that was about to attack them. As they lined up for the first pass going in on this column of vehicles, Riley Schamberger yelled over the radio, "I'm hit, I'm hit." Shannon saw white smoke coming from Schamberger's B-26. Schamberger and Gray were headed into the water in a shallow dive at about 300 miles an hour with a Cuban T-33 fighter on their tail. Riley Schamberger and his crewman, Wade Gray, crashed into the water with their plane at about 300 miles per hour. Their bodies were never recovered. Shannon later said, "I knew I had to do something in a hurry because I was probably next. Being a World War II fighter pilot, my reaction was the only logical thing to do. I turned into the T-33. That T-33 pulled up to avoid me, and I just continued on around. I never did see that T-33 again. He was almost vertical when I saw him last." Shannon spoiled the T-33's attack, but he was forced to drop his ordnance off target. Shannon, in making his escape, took advantage of the early morning sun, which he says was hanging right on the coast. He got as close to the water as he could at full throttle, heading east to southeast for about 5 minutes. If the T-33 tried to find him, it would have been looking into the rising sun. Further inland, Pete Ray's bomber was brought down by either Cuban ground fire or aircraft. The reports varied depending on the source. Either way, the B-26 was crippled and made a forced landing about a mile from the Australia Central sugar mill. The two crewmen, Ray and Baker, leapt out before the plane burst into flames, but were killed ostensibly resisting capture. After flying southeast about 20 miles, Shannon and Sedano turned south and gained altitude for their return to Happy Valley, Nicaragua. On the way, they saw two unmarked Navy A-4 jet fighters from the Navy Task Force. It appears that the Navy was not on site due to a time mix-up, possibly due to the different time zones the two operations were being conducted in. No definitive answer for the failure of the Navy and the CIA planes to rendezvous has ever been proven. The invasion collapsed that afternoon and CIA combat flights ceased. But at 3:30 p.m., Cuban planes again attacked Giron with two B-26s, two Sea Furies, and two 33s launching rockets, bombs, and machine gun fire on the invading forces. The air battle at the Bay of Pigs is now over. April 20th, 1961. The U.S. Navy flies patrols and reconnaissance flights around Cuba in unmarked aircraft. They are not challenged. 6 months later, October 1961. The wreckage of the missing B-26 number 933 and its two crew, pilot Crispin Garcia Fernandez and navigator Juan Gonzalez Romero, were found in the Nicaraguan jungle. The cause of the crash is never determined. 1968, Cuban Sea Fury pilot Douglas Rudd is arrested by Cuban intelligence for wanting to take a job flying for Air France. He is forced to spend the rest of his life living on the fringes of Cuban society. In 1990, he is allowed to leave Cuba. In 1992, he dies in Miami in the home of one of his former adversaries. 1978, the CIA declassified critical documents and posthumously awarded Schamberger, Gray, Ray, and Baker the Distinguished Intelligence Cross, the agency's highest award for bravery. 1979, after years of persistent prodding by Pete Ray's daughter, the U.S. government convinced the Castro regime to return Ray's body for a military burial. Castro had kept the body as proof of U.S. involvement in the Bay of Pigs operation. Leo Baker, who had darker features, was possibly assumed to be Latino, and his body was buried with the rest of the dead invaders in Cuba. But Pete Ray now rests at Forest Hill Cemetery in Birmingham, Alabama, overlooking the Birmingham Airport. 1987. Bay of Pigs T-33 jet pilot and now general in the Cuban Air Force, Rafael de Pino, defects from Cuba. He later flies a twin Cessna from Florida to Cuba, makes an off-field landing, retrieves his family, and returns safely to Florida. He now lives in Europe.
Nunca podré morir, mi corazón no lo tengo aquí. Allá me está esperando, me está guardando que vuelva allí. Cuando salí de Cuba, dejé mi vida, dejé mi amor. Cuando salí de Cuba, dejé enterrado mi corazón. Late y sigue latiendo, porque mi tierra vida le da. Pero llegará el día en que mi mano lo encontrará. Cuando salí de Cuba, dejé mi vida, dejé mi amor. Cuando salí de Cuba, dejé enterrado mi corazón. Cuba, aunque me encuentro lejos de ti, añoro el verde de tus campos, el azul de tu cielo, el agua clara de tus playas y lo ardiente de tu sol. Una triste tormenta está azotando sin descansar, pero el sol de tus hijos pronto la calma te hará alcanzar. Dejé mi madre, dejé mi amor.